In Pit Lane is proudly brought to you by Dynotech by Dyno Dynamics. For your nearest workshop, visit our website. And with the support of the Ramada Resort, Phillip Island.
Welcome back to In Pit Lane, live from the studios of RMITV here in downtown beautiful Grand Prix City, Melbourne. Well, as we said, coming up in a couple of weeks' time is the Bathurst 1000. Our guest tonight will be one of the main competitors there. He's a former winner of the event, but he's had the most amazing year. I mean, when you look at it, he's become a father, he's got engaged, he's won the Jason Richards Memorial Trophy Race at Pukekohe, and he's fulfilled a lifelong ambition to race at the Le Mans 24-hour race. And the year's not over yet. There's still plenty to come. Let's find out about it with our special guest, Jason Bright. Jason, welcome to In Pit Lane.
Good to be here.
Now, let's start off with Le Mans for a start. Ever since I've known you, I mean, you've had this ambition to drive at Le Mans. We've often spoken about it. Just go back to the first day you were there, the test day. You go in the gate and through the tunnel, and your first sight of the Le Mans track. How do you feel?
No, it was pretty special. I mean, you know, it was certainly a race that I've wanted to do for a long time, and it's a race that's on a lot of drivers' bucket lists. So, you know, to rock up there and get to do the test and sort of know at that point that it's all, you know, definitely happening was pretty special. I walked the track that day, or as much as I could, because most of it's public roads at that point. So, you know, to sort of walk it and see a lot of the corners that you know from photos, you know from watching the race on television was pretty special.
So when you say you walk it, I mean, for people who don't know, how long is it around? It's a long...
It's about 13.7 kilometres, I think. But it's, there's, you know, the sort of section from the Porsche curves right through to where the start of the Mulsanne, you know, that's all, you know, closed to the public. So you can sort of walk that section. So I walked each way from the pits and back again. So it was, you know, it's a pretty long lap. But yeah, the boring part where you're sort of on Mulsanne for nearly 50% of the lap is Mulsanne, and then the next section leading up to the Porsche curves is all pretty much straight. So it's there's a great section of road from the Porsche curves all the way through to where the Mulsanne starts, and that's the interesting bit.
So being that it's such a large track by any standards, but certainly by Australian standards, even with Bathurst, how hard is it to learn the track and get comfortable with it?
It is extremely hard. You know, the biggest difficulty I had this year was the weather. You're sort of sharing with two other drivers, and you know, the amount of track time you have is actually quite a bit of time, but the weather was just shocking. I only got 13 laps in the dry at the test, and there was a total of about 8 hours running at the test. And, you know, there was only the last part of the day that was dry, and it was really only just a dry line, you know, and learning a track and going through the Porsche curves, which is a series of corners that are around 200 kilometres an hour. When there's just a dry line, there's only a certain amount you can sort of learn, because you know if you sort of run just a fraction wide, you're in trouble. And at the race week, I didn't actually do a dry lap in the daylight until the morning warm-up. So that shows you how little amount of time we actually had in the dry, and it was that made it really hard. You know, it was learning a 13-kilometre circuit and doing, you know, a total of about 20 laps in the dry leading up to the race is pretty tough.
The other thing that you'd have to come to grips with that you haven't had experience in for a long, long time is the fact that you're not necessarily the fastest guy out there. There's these things called LMP2 and LMP1. How difficult was that? And when they went past you, when the Audis and Toyota went past you for the first time, what went through your mind?
Well, I mean, the most difficult part, again, is the Porsche curves. You know, they're a corner that even the GT car, you can take, like, the minimum speed through the whole section is about 180 kilometres an hour. And you arrive there and you're on the limit, and the Audis and even some of the LMP2 cars can just drive around your outside. And when they do that, you get to the next part where you're sort of changing direction and they basically put you offline and you're already sort of on the limit. So, you know, I'd been warned quite a bit about it. You know, it was the other time that I'd raced a car that was not the quickest car out there was the Peugeot at Bathurst this year. And the difference with that was we're actually pretty quick across the top of the mountain and you know, you didn't have the GT3 cars driving around your outside. And in this situation, you know, we were quick enough down the straights that they weren't, you know, you could sort of see them coming, but you knew when they were sort of coming up on you in the Porsche curves to sort of watch out because they're going to try and drive around your outside.
Of course, getting onto the race yourself, it was a mixed emotions for all of us, of course, because we unfortunately lost our good friend Alan Simonson. And from your point of view, I mean, you were there. I wasn't there this year, and I was almost grateful this year for a change that I wasn't there. How hard was it to keep racing under those circumstances when you heard the news? And when did you find out the news?
It was very difficult. You know, I knew Alan pretty well, and I was in the car when the crash happened. I was out of the car very soon after, and I was pretty concerned about him because I thought I saw them, you know, attending to someone. But I was told that he, you know, got out and went to the medical centre and he was okay. So, you know, it took a long time for the news to filter through. I was back in the car after a couple of hours, and I think I did, you know, around a 3-hour stint at that point. So I didn't get back out of the car till about 9 o'clock that night, and that was the first time that I was told. So the hard part then was sort of going back to the motorhome and you know, my family was there, my young son. Alan had a young daughter who, you know, he's left behind. So that made the rest of the race extremely difficult. You know, getting back in the car and you know, I've never actually competed in a race where someone's died before. So that was, you know, it was all new to me at that point. So it made the rest of the race difficult, but, you know, obviously we all had to sort of keep on racing in Alan's name.
You've got a job to do, of course, but as you say, you think about your family. I know at the time, I'm assuming you've seen it since, but at the time your fiancée, Lucy, put something on Facebook, I think, which said, you know, oh my God, something along the lines of, oh my God, please stop this race, I want my fiancée back. And that really sort of, I mean, I don't know how you must have felt, but that hit me. How hard is it to turn around and to say to the mother of your child, I'm getting back in that car and I'm going out again?
Yeah, I mean, Lucy's been around racing a long time, so she sort of knows the dangers. And you know, Alan's accident was a pretty freak accident. You know, it can happen.
No doubt about that.
And you know, he was just extremely lucky. There was several different factors that, even if one of them was different, he would have survived. And, you know, the most unfortunate part is, you know, I think that the worst part was that curb just should not have been painted. You know, and the way that he hit, the way that he came off the end of the curb, the angle that he hit the fence at, the fact that there was a tree behind the fence, all added up to it being a much bigger impact than what it should have been. And, you know, we just have to do everything we can to avoid those sort of situations.
Well, we go from one of the world's great races to another one of the world's great races, which is Bathurst, in a couple of weeks' time, and we'll get onto that subject as soon as we come back. But right now we're going to take a break on In Pit Lane. You are watching In Pit Lane. We're live right across Melbourne and Geelong on Channel 31. We'll be right back. Don't go away. Welcome back to In Pit Lane. Our guest live in the studio is Jason Bright. Now, just a quick message about next week's program. Next week is going to be the In Pit Lane Big Bathurst Bash. We're going to have a live band in the studio, and you can be part of the studio audience. Now, we've got very, very limited space in here, so very limited tickets. But if you'd like to be a part of the studio audience and enjoy the sound of Leroy and the Sound playing live, and they are a great band, check them out at Triple J Unearthed, then you can just go to the In Pit Lane website right now, fill out the form to express your interest, and yes, reliving the glory days of Good Morning Australia. I don't know if we're going to have Belvedere here or not. Belvedere, if you're out there, you're welcome to come on in. Jason, let's get back to the matter at hand, which in a couple of weeks' time is the Bathurst 1000. Now that it's part of the V8 Supercar Championship, you've got so many big events out there, the Clipsal and the race at Homebush and all the rest, is it still the very special race that it always used to be?
Oh, there's no doubt about that. You know, it's still the race that, you know, if you're sort of having a bad year, it's the one you want to win. You know, there's nothing else that sort of comes second. You know, personally, it was still always a big enough race to stand on its own two feet. It didn't need to be part of the championship, I don't think. And, you know, in some ways, I believe that it almost takes a little bit away from it. And years where you've got guys that are battling for a championship, and you might only have two or three of those that are seriously in the championship hunt, and then you've got the rest of the field that can go there and have a red hot go and not have to worry about the championship. I don't know that that's too fair, but you know, it does play a big part in our championship. You know, being one race worth 300 points, it can really hurt you, same as Sandown did for us a couple of weeks ago.
You had some real problems at Sandown. You had some handling problems. Have you tracked all that down? Are you aware of what happened?
Well, yeah, we have. It was pretty disappointing because, you know, we had pretty good pace Friday and all things just started to go a little bit pear-shaped as of Saturday. And then by Sunday, we really struggled. And by end of the race, we had damaged uprights or they were cracked. We had even one of the suspension points was damaged. So, you know, it was pretty disappointing. I think that Sandown is very hard on the car. The curbs there, you do hit them very hard. And, fortunately, if there is one good thing, it's a track that doesn't normally suit us this year. You know, I think that the faster flowing circuits like Pookie, even Tasmania, that you don't really use the curbs and it's nice and smooth, suited us very well. So hopefully we go to Bathurst and we can have a much, much better run.
So what do you think about, apart from yourself, I mean, the thing that makes Bathurst different this year and what drew a really big crowd to Sandown, I mean, it was the biggest crowd I've seen in a long, long time out at Sandown, and I'm assuming that Bathurst is going to be the same, is the addition of the Nissans and the Mercedes. Are they a factor at all? I mean, a few weeks ago, you would have said, no, not a chance. But after Winton and Sandown with the Mercedes performance there, they can't be totally ruled out, can they?
Oh, absolutely not. You know, they've both been getting better and better as the year goes on. And the Mercedes has got its strengths at the moment. You know, it was very strong at Sandown. You know, it had good straight line speed. So at Bathurst, that's going to count for a lot. And the Nissans are very good on, you know, high downforce circuits. You know, they were good at the Grand Prix, even though the Grand Prix's got quite long straights. The speed that you could carry off a lot of the corners and they're obviously good at Winton. They'll be quick across the top of the mountain. I think they've got a lot of drag, you know, to get that downforce that they've got. So I think they will struggle up and down, you know, the mountain. But they're certainly contenders at different circuits at the moment. It's anyone's race. We've seen more winners this year than any other year in the championship, and I don't think the last part of the year is going to be any different.
Of course, you know, you mentioned the weather at Le Mans before. It was, as I think I said to you on Facebook, it always rains at Le Mans. That's the opening line of the Truth in 24 documentary. But this year it just kept raining. I've never seen it like that. You might bring some Le Mans rain with you. I mean, is that something that might suit you?
Our cars were very quick at Winton in the wet. We were really happy with the pace we had there. But Bathurst is a different circuit again. You know, it's, not every, like... It's one of those tracks where you can go there and expect everything to be going well for you, and it's no different in the wet. You know, a car that works on the wet, you know, the short circuit like Winton, where it's all just about straight power down and confidence on tight corners, might not necessarily work at Bathurst. So, you know, I'm pretty confident that we've got as good a package as anyone, wet or dry, but you just never know until you get there and see how it pans out. But the challenge of Bathurst is normally not so much having a car that works great in the wet, is being on the right tyre at the right time. And when it's raining there, it can be wet up the top of the mountain, dry down the bottom, and then, you know, that changes after, you know, a handful of laps, and you can easily be caught out on the wrong tyre very easily there.
So what do you think of the strategy? Is normally a big part of Bathurst, and this year there's going to be a minimum number of pit stops because of, you know, the dreaded word parity. What do you think of that? I mean, would you like to just go back to the old days where you can choose how many times you've stopped?
It'd be great to go back to the old days and do that, but at the moment, you know, we do need to do something to, you know, make it easier for those new manufacturers coming in. It is a shame to have to bring rules in those situations, but at the end of the day, it's the same for everyone. I think the seven stops and the four stops that we had compulsory at Sandown, doesn't end up changing the race too much, but it does, you know, it does make it easier for the teams that are struggling for fuel economy. So I'm sure as they, you know, as these teams get better with their fuel economy, hopefully we can go back to the way it used to be.
Well, good luck at Bathurst, and good luck for the rest of the year, and also hopefully we'll see you back at Le Mans next year, and hopefully there'll be a bit of fine weather. Also, I understand you're trying to get a drive at the Daytona 24-hour, and that would be good to see you as well. But best of luck. Thanks for coming in. But for now, Jason Bright, thanks for joining us in Pit Lane.
Cheers.
And thank you to you at home. As I said, next week we'll have a big preview of Bathurst. We have the band Leroy and the Sound live in the studio for a couple of songs. And, of course, you can come in and be a part of the studio audience as well. Just go to inpitlane.com for all those details. But that's all we've got time for this week. On behalf of everybody here at RMITV and Channel 31, it's been good to have you at home as your company. Until next week, from all of us here, bye for now.
More power, better fuel economy, a cleaner, more efficient engine. They're just a few of the advantages of having your car tuned on a Dynotech dyno. To find your nearest Dynotech workshop, go to dyno.com.au. Dynotech by Dyno Dynamics.